it always helps to reinforce these messages. It always helps to make sure that people are up to date with their training and to reinforce the messages that we've already got out there.
Let's talk to Alex Brew, who is from the campaign group Women Against Rape. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Do you agree with Alison Saunders that the experience of alleged victims of sexual violence has got better when it comes to dealings with the authorities?
Well, what she says all sounds, you know, very reasonable, but what we see in practice is absolutely the opposite of what she's describing. We see prejudiced and shoddy investigations when it comes to rape, and we see that, you know, they go after women with absolute vigour if they want to prosecute the woman, you know, for malicious communications, for harassment or for false allegation. And that's what we see time and again, and nothing is changing. These measures are nothing new at all, and we are absolutely, you know, we just think that it's actually putting women into huge amounts of danger, that they are talking as though they're on the side of the victim, when actually the reality is the absolute opposite, you know.
I mean, that is a generalisation. I mean, I have talked to a number of alleged victims of sexual crimes over the years. And for some of those women, as the years have gone by, their experience with the authorities has definitely improved. It is not like 10 years ago, 15 years ago, is it?
Well, the reality is still the same, that, you know, 94% of rapists are getting away with it, and yet they're still going after...
How do you know that? Where do you get that figure from?
Well, we know that only 6.5% of rapists are convicted, and that's just for reported rapes. And we know that there's a whole load of rapes that go unreported because women are far too scared to approach the police, because they know that what can often happen is the investigation turns around and focuses on them.
But not anymore, according to Alison Saunders.
Well, we applied to the DPP in the case of Rhiannon Brooker to ask that he didn't go ahead when it was Keir Starmer, to ask that it didn't go ahead. We've spoken to Alison Saunders as well, and actually we found that they went after her with all guns blazing. There was a dawn raid on her house. There were 10 officers arrested her. She spent hours and hours in a cell, and in the end she said, to make it go away, okay, I've lied, I'll say I lied to make it go away. And now she's been prosecuted and she's been found guilty of a false allegation. And we just feel that that's a miscarriage of justice, not just for her as an individual, but for all women who want to go forward and report rape. We know from the IPCC and we know from PC Patrick, the whistleblower who came out last year.
Yeah, she's been on this programme a couple of times.
Yeah, that, you know, that women are being pressurised to withdraw their statements. And it's very easy for that to be the first step. And the next step is for them to be prosecuted themselves. And we found in this case,
they can only be successfully prosecuted if there's evidence to convict beyond reasonable doubt in front of, you know, 12 men and women like you, me and anybody listening to this programme.
Right. And in this case, what they relied on was some inaccuracies in dates and some text messages. But we say that given that it was a domestic violence situation of 2 years, you just can't expect people to get exactly the dates right on all of those counts. They were also using, a document that she had written, not for the police, and the police signed that off. She had to sign that off as her statement. She was really pressurised to do that. She didn't want to do that, and actually in court that was used against her, that some of the things that she'd written in there weren't exactly right. She hadn't got the dates exactly right, and that was used against her.
I don't know the details of this case, but this she is appealing against the conviction?
We don't know yet what is going to happen, if she's going to be able to appeal. But we do know that, I mean, I sat through that parts of that trial, and we do know that she, you know, the prosecutor used rape myths against her, saying, well, she should have cried out. Why didn't she cry out? Why didn't she use her police rape alarm? You know, there were various rape myths. We also... you know, found that the prosecutor lied about her, saying that she'd failed her bar examinations, and that's why that was her motive for doing this. Actually, she was in the top 10%. She was getting 80%. You know, the juries, you know, When a prosecutor says something like that, the juries don't expect that the prosecutor has lied about that.
Right, I was not sitting in that case. I've no idea whether what you've just said about the prosecutor is true or not. Clearly, the woman concerned will have her own defence team and presumably was rebutting all of this, as one would expect a defence team to do. But in the end, a jury believed the prosecution and didn't believe the defendant.
Yeah, and that is the sad case, that, you know, the police will go after gathering evidence against women on these false allegation cases or on malicious communication cases, and they don't do the same when we go to them about rape. We had a case last week, actually, that we've been dealing with, of a woman who had threats over the phone. She'd recorded these threats, and we had to ask the police and the CPS, have you listened to the tapes of these threats? Because we were so surprised at the low charge, and actually they hadn't listened to the tapes. So there is a real imbalance here on how they go after women who have reported rape and how they go after rapists. And, okay, you know, it's they're basically allowing women to be raped and murdered.
Thank you. Alex Brew from the campaign group Women Against Rape at